Hey, Professor Rick Rapetti here. Our topic for today is the six orthodox darshans. Darshan is a Sanskrit word which literally means vision, but informally it means philosophies, perspectives on reality. They are orthodox Indian darshans, or orthodox Indian philosophies. And what makes a philosophy in Indian philosophy orthodox is whether or not it's based on the Vedas, the Indian scriptures, which I've talked about in the previous lecture. Okay, so let me share my screen. By the way, you're listening to Krishna Das. Mahakali Durge Namo Namo. That's him. Kirtan means devotional responsive chanting. The kirtan leader chants a mantra, and then the audience chants it back, back and forth, back and forth. So it's like a conversation. It's devotional, it's a form of meditation. Since we're doing orthodox Indian philosophies, kirtan is part of it. So I thought I'd play that in the background. All right, let me share my screen and get my PowerPoint slides up here. Turn that slideshow on. Six orthodox Indian darshanas. Darshans. The S is pronounced as an H, S-H, the first S in darshan, darshanas. Visions, views, philosophies, perspectives. So here's the six, and they come in three pairs of two. The first two are vaisheshika, which is a kind of metaphysics about atomism, kind of like Democritus and our pre-Socratic nature philosopher from ancient Greece, right? Atomism. There are many things in the world, and they're made of little stuffs, right? Four elements, generally, right? Maybe more than four. But there are many things, not just one, okay? And nyaya, like nya-nya-nya-nya-nya-nya, nyaya, followers of nyaya are, by the way, are called nyayikas or nyayikas, is the logic school. They accept the metaphysics of the vaisheshika school, which just talks about how many things there are. What is the world made out of? It's made out of atoms of different kinds combined, right? And then logic identifies things like Aristotle's logic, right, and tells you how to reason about those things that exist in reality. All right, so they go together because the Nyaya logic school accepts the metaphysics of the Vaisheshika school. Okay, that's the first pair. Second pair, items three and four, are the Yoga school and the Samkhya philosophy. Okay, so Samkhya has a kind of dualistic metaphysics. There's two different kinds of things, basically consciousness or spirit and matter. Okay. And I should have put that first because that's the metaphysics, right? And in the first pair, you've got the metaphysics first. And then the second item in the first pair is method, logic, right? Logic is your method for knowing reality according to that metaphysics. Well, here in the second pair, this dualistic metaphysics of spirit and matter, right? What's the method of dealing with that, or knowing it, or coming to realize it, or become enlightened about it, have knowledge about it, experiential knowledge, is the method of yoga, the liberating method of meditation, which frees the spirit from the matter. Right? That's yoga philosophy, right? I'll say a lot more about each of these schools. And then the last two are mimamsa, which reminds me always of a mimosa, which is vodka and orange juice served at the buffet, usually. There's no alcohol in here. This is tonic water and lime juice and a little bit of stevia sweetener and ice cubes. So when I pause, you get to hear Krishna Das, who's my friend, by the way. He's the world-renowned chant master, the Kirtan Wala, they call him. A Wala in India is someone who sells something, like a Chai Wala. Sells chai, which is tea. Right? He's a Kirtan Wala. He sells Kirtan, or he peddles it. It's not necessarily for sale. Sometimes it is, if it's a concert. Okay, so Mimamsa is a kind of epistemology school that rests entirely on the early Vedas, which is all about rituals, right? To uphold, and we talked about this in the last lecture, to uphold the cosmic order, Rita, right? And then Dharma is your duty, your role in that Rita, in that cosmic order, right? But the Vedas, the scriptures, because they emanate from the ultimate reality, are considered the highest source of knowledge. So that's a kind of epistemology, right? And then there's other things like perception and reasoning and testimony, right? But the philosophy based on them, the last item on the list is Vedanta. Anta means end. It's the end of the Vedas, which is the Upanishads. We talked about that in the previous lecture, the Upanishads. Whereas the early Vedas are all about rituals to uphold the cosmic order, the Upanishads are more about meditation-based path to enlightenment and freedom of the soul, right? So it's about turning inward and not propitiating the gods, but really propitiating the self, of finding the self, the Atman, to be one with Brahman, right? So, but there's also the metaphysics, of Vedanta, which is that, well, there's two branches. One says everything is one. There's only the one, Brahman. Everything else is an illusion, not really separate from Brahman. And then the other school that says, no, there's really two. And that's more like Western religions. God is one thing and all the rest of us are something else, right? So there's Brahman and then there's non-Brahman, which is the created world, which includes created beings, all right? So that's a really short overview of the six major orthodox Indian philosophies. Once again, they're all orthodox because they all accept the authority of the Vedas, right? So it's kind of like different forms of Christianity, let's just say that, like, you know, Lutheranism, Methodist, Presbyterian, Baptist, Catholic, and so on, right? All interpreting the Bible in different ways, but they're all Christian because they're all based on the New Testament and they all accept Jesus, right? So it's kind of like that. These six schools are orthodox schools of Vedic philosophy. That's what makes them orthodox, that they're Vedic. And we talked about that in the previous slide. Astika, asta having to do with being. They are like followers of being. They are orthodox. They're based in reality, right? The Vedas is the highest reality emanating from the one, right? That kind of thing. Okay. So let's go into each school one at a time. So Vaisheshika is atomistic pluralism or dualism, right? We often use the term dualism in metaphysics to talk about anything more than one. So pluralism is sometimes a form of dualism, but when you say pluralism, then it means at least more than one, right? So maybe pluralism would be the better, right? So you've got substance, padartha, right? Which breaks into two kind of modes, being and non-being. Bhava represents being. The word has multiple meanings. Or non-being, which is the negation of bhava. So it's abhava, like atheism is not believing in theism, right? So on the six sides of being, you've got these six categories or types of being. And on the right side, you have non-being. So this is like the absence of something or the non-existence of something. Parmenides, our friend in ancient Greek philosophy, would deny the right side and say there's no such thing as non-being, right? But in this philosophy, non-being has a kind of reality. It's an absence or an emptiness, right? So you could say the non-being of Santa Claus or of the Great Pumpkin or a certain student who's not in class today, right? Or the absence of an elephant in your bedroom right now, right? So this is a way of talking about things. It's like, you know, is your friend Harvey here? Look around. No, there's no Harvey here. So that's an absence or a negation, right? Just to give you a little bit of an idea about it. So this is a kind of metaphysics, like Aristotle had a metaphysics where he tried to talk about the categories of reality or being, right? Quantity, quality, relations, substances and their attributes, things that are necessary or accidental, actual or potential. These are modes of being, right? So you've got this complex atomistic philosophy here in ancient Indian Orthodox philosophy. So the being comes in six modes, you might want to say, or forms. Substance, right? Like wax is a substance, right? Or a substance at a crime scene. That's in ordinary language, but a substance in for Aristotle and for the Vaisheshikas is something that has qualities or characteristics or properties. So wax does, right? So does water. So does anything that exists in material form has qualities to it. Size, shape, color, all those things, right? That's number two, qualities, right? Then actions are real, like running down the street or eating a sandwich or digesting a sandwich. Your stomach is performing an action. Generality is a fancy word for something like a universal, if you recall, from Plato and Aristotle. The form of redness is Plato's version of a generality. All red things share in the form of redness, but Aristotle said, no, all red things just happen to be red. They're not linked together to some abstract thing called redness, right? Those forms inhere in the objects. They're only in the objects, in the red things, right? So there's the abstract or universal, like redness or roundness, right? These are things that can be, these are general attributes that can be shared by an infinite number of objects, like roundness or redness or wetness or coldness, right? But then this particular apple has this particular shade of red. That's item number five on the list, right? Universals and particulars. So it's almost the same thing as Aristotle. But then there's this interesting thing, which is the relationship between the particular and the universal, right? And Plato might have liked this idea, but Aristotle thought that there is no real thing outside of the particular, right? Aristotle will have a problem with number four. Plato would like number four, but Plato might like number six because what links the general thing, redness, to this particular red apple? It's the relationship of inherence. Redness, the universal, inheres in the object in the red apple as its redness, right? So that's that relation of inhering. You might think, well, this distinction is all just conceptual. There's nothing like that in reality. Whatever, those are metaphysical questions. What things exist? What kinds of beings, what kinds of things have being, and what kinds of things are real? What kinds of things exist, right? This is like a metaphysical question. What's real, right? Are universals real? Is redness real, or is it, or only red things real? Is the relationship between redness and red things, the relationship of inherence, is that a real thing? Or on the right side of the board, is the non-existence of something real? Parmenides would say no, right? But Harvey's absence from my little room here right now, I grew up with a whole Harvey family. There was about eight of them in that family. There's no Harveys in the room right now. So that's a kind of reality, but it's like a negative reality. Oh, I have notes about this. Yes, so vishesha means particularities, unique things. And that's why when you put ika at the end of something like astika, nastika, nyayika, a follower of the nyaya or logic school, that's what the ika means, like a follower of that doctrine. So Vaisheshika are, the Ika is the followers of the doctrine of particularities, right? So there's an emphasis, like in Aristotle, on particulars. The apple that's red, right? Those are the most real things in a sense, right? So this is a very Aristotelian, grounded in physical objects kind of metaphysics. Okay, the Vedas also depict many gods, right? That the gods are real. Humans are real and separate from each other. So this one thing, the one, right? They reject that idea. There are gods, there are humans, there are animals, there are objects, there are things, there are rocks, there are actions, there's killings, there's eatings, there's running, there's rain, you know, there's thunder. These are all elements of reality. What things are real? The little boy asks his parents, and his mother says, you know, your homework is real. Go do your homework. Okay. So yeah, each of these real things has distinct ways of being, of acting, and of interacting with other things. And so those kinds of actions and interactions and relationships are all parts of reality, right? Like it's real that this is my right hand as opposed to my left hand. And my right hand is across from, it's on the right side of my face, and my left hand is on the left side. The relationship to the right of and to the left of is a part of reality, right? Or is it, right? My hands are part of reality, but where they're placed, it's just kind of like a location, but to the left of and to the right of depends on where you're looking at it from, right? So look in the mirror, right? Right hand, left hand. When I look in the mirror and I move my left hand, it looks like the person in the mirror is moving his right hand. Try it, right? So to the left of and to the right of might be some kind of illusion. I'm just playing with some metaphysics with you here. Okay, moving right along. The Vedas do imply a pluralistic metaphysics, right? There's more than one. How many beings, the number of beings? There's many, right? There's gods, there's people, animals, things, objects, relationships, all the things on the list, even absences are real, okay? And the Vedas are an authority, right? Only because they express the Dharma in the other sense of kind of the orderliness of the universe, right? The law, like duty and law are very interrelated ideas. Dharma is kind of like Rita in this sense, right? The Vedas are like the laws of the universe verbalizing themselves through the mouths of sages, right? So they're an authority because they express the ultimate reality. Remember when we talked about in a previous lecture? Dharma with a capital D is the nature of reality. That version of the concept is big in Buddhism, by the way, right? Okay, and remember, it's upheld by ritual action. Rita is the better word for the cosmic order that's upheld by each of us doing our dharma, but we partake in the dharma of the whole universe, which is interrelated. Okay. So metaphysics, it's a concern to catalog types of being. And there's that list again on the right side. Seven padartha, or categories of being or of reality, right? Which includes non-existence, right? The first six are things that exist. And then there's this category Parmenides would reject, things that don't exist. It's real that there are absences or things that don't exist, right? It's true and it's real that there are no unicorns, right? Okay, so metaphysics is a concern with cataloging the kinds and types of beings that exist. It's a study of reality, what things are real, right? So it's a concern also to know the cosmic order and our place in it, our particular role, right? Knowing the categories of being is knowing reality. Knowing what's real, what world am I in, right? A baby is born, it's flailing its arms, and after a while, it realizes those are my arms, right? Like, but what's this world like? And you use your senses and your reason to figure it out. Metaphysics is kind of grown-ups acting like babies. What do you mean you don't understand reality, right? But that's what philosophy is. It's, let's think about this again. Do we really get it? Do we understand reality, right? Is the non-presence of Harvey in my room a part of reality? What does that mean? How is our language misleading us? These are some serious questions that not only Western philosophers asked, but throughout the history of Indian philosophy, the logicians and the grammarians and the nyayikas, the followers of the school of logic, and the mimamsa folks, the epistemologists, they're all asking these kinds of questions. They have a very complex philosophy of language. It's amazing that we didn't realize this in the West until recently. Okay, a category is the word padartha is a category. Categories of what? Of things that exist or that are real, right? Another way of looking at it is verbally or linguistically. I mentioned philosophy of language. So it's a category, but a category is what a word refers to, like the category of dogs, right? So, and there's this belief in the philosophy of language in this school of thought, Vaisheshika, the particularities followers, right? Followers of the particulars school. This is a name, dog. So there's a category of particular beings that are dogs that are in the category dog. This dog, that dog, and the other dog, they're all in the category of dogs, right? So if a word refers to a thing like dog, then that thing has real being, right? So by analyzing ordinary language, we can figure out what kinds of things really exist. In Western philosophy in the 20th century, this was a prominent approach called ordinary language philosophy. Just analyze the way we use language, because metaphysics is built into our language. We've got nouns that refer to things that are real, and we've got verbs that refer to actions that are real, right? So metaphysics is built into our linguistic behavior, our language structure. A language is a kind of map of metaphysics. Analyze the language and you could extract the metaphysics from it. Hopi Indians, by the way, have different tenses. They have a different sense of time than we do. Right, by linguists analyzing the language that the Hopi in the southwest of the United States spoke, and still speak, right? They have a different kind of metaphysics built into their language. The natives of Alaska, the Inuit people, have 50 some odd different words for snow. So they make, because they live in a snowy world, so they can differentiate all different kinds of snow patterns that we normally can't. What do we have? Packing snow, we can make snowballs with. Couple of words for snow, slush, whatever, right? Okay, so by analyzing language, that's the point. You can extract the metaphysics. So seven padarthas or categories of being, there they are again, right? When I told you in the previous lecture, I believe that the word karma means action literally. So there it is, item number three, right? It doesn't just mean what goes around comes around. That's just the consequences of action, which are considered part of the full thing that an action is. You perform an action is like a domino. You knock that domino down, it hits the next one. You light a match, it starts a fire, it burns a forest down, it kills people. That's all part of the action, part of the karma of that initial action, right? So this is a different metaphysics of action that includes all the consequences of it built into the word karma. Okay, all right, so there's those categories again. Substance is the kind of stuff that a thing is. The qualities let you know what kind of stuff it is, like wax. It could be melted and reshaped. It could be liquid. It could be solid. It takes on the form of something that it's in when it dries. Otherwise, it's a liquid, right? Those are qualities of wax. And the word guna is for qualities. And there's three gunas, which I mentioned, I think, in the previous lecture. Sattva, rajas, and tamas. Sattva is the pure one. Rajas is the active one, and tamas is the dull or heavy one, right? It's kind of like yin yang and neutral. Visesa, number five, is the particular thing, the uniqueness. It's almost like the species. Aristotle gives you the genus. That would be item number four, maybe, right? Like primate, and then the species, number five, is what's unique about this primate? Oh, it's a lemur. Or it's a baboon or something like that. It's a spider monkey, right? Okay, and that should be inherence. INJ is a typo, but I copied this chart off the internet, so we'll just deal with that. Oh, that's Maharaji. Ram Dass and Krishna Dass's guru. I like this song. I'll take a sip while I listen. Om Namah Shivaya. Okay. So let's look at each of them now on the list, right? Here's the seven items. Now we're going to go through each one. We're going to go in depth with the first one, and then we'll do a little bit less about each one as we move along with the other five Orthodox schools, and then some non-Orthodox ones are going to be on the list too. So when you think about a substance, right, it's a diagram of like an atom, but you know, substances are made of atoms, right? But this is an atomistic school, right? So we call common sense realism the view that when you look around the world and you see tables and chairs and rocks and the moon and the earth and hoodies, which I'm going to take off, even though I only have my tank top on, but it's getting warm in here. This is the joys of teaching from home remotely. I can be in my pajamas and lecture. So common sense realism, like what does common sense tell you is real, right? The objects of your senses are real. If you can see it, smell it, touch it, taste it, or feel it, or knock on it, weigh it, measure it, take a picture of it, bump into it, then it's real, right? So you bump into substances, right? Like sand or stone or water or whatever. All other things reduced to a substance or rest on it in some way, right? They're built up out of or aspects or properties of substances, right? Like a living organism is a substance in a sense. It's a biological substance that's highly complex and structured and self-regulating, self-improving, right? It's a mechanism system, right? But a rock is also a substance. So these complex and simple substances like water or an ice sculpture, right? Nine kinds of substance atoms. And just like in Democritus, the ancient Greek, atom, A means not, and tom means divisible. So it's the tiniest little units that we can't break down any further. We'll consider them atoms. Earth, water, fire, air, ether, space, time, self, and mind. Now, when we get to yoga, you'll see that there's seven substances connected with the chakras, those energy centers in the body. But for now, we've got earth, water, fire, air, ether, and in that other system, there's only mind. But space and time and self are considered substances because they're considered real. Time is real. It's like an action, right? Time flows, right? Space is real. Objects exist in space. They have a location, right? Like my hand is in this part of space. Now it's in this part of space. This part. Space is real. Time is real. What I said a minute ago was a minute ago, right? So time is real. Space is real. Ether is kind of like something in between air and space or something like that. It's kind of very subtle, like what radio waves might travel through. You don't see them. It's some kind of, you know, it might not exist, right? From a scientific point of view, experiments were done. Michelson-Morley, I believe, were the ones who showed the physicists that there's no such thing as ether, because if it did exist, it could have been detected with this experiment, and it wasn't. That's a negation, okay? The self is considered real, the Atman, and mind is real. Right. This is their metaphysics. There's multiple ways of dividing up reality, like the Eskimos. That's not a politically correct way of referring to them anymore. The Inuit people, the natives of Alaska, I apologize. I was raised calling them that, and we never thought that it was a negative term. All right, substance. So there's nine kinds of substance atoms. What is a substance? It's what it is that has a quality, right? So an orange that you eat has the color orange, right? That's a quality, and it's juicy, right? These are qualities of it, right? An apple is a substance because it has a roundness quality and it has a redness quality. A person is a substance because you have a body which has a size and a shape and a temperature and a color and all sorts of things, right? What exists through a series of changes is a substance. So take that wax candle, heat it up in the glass that it's in, it becomes liquid, pour it into a different shaped glass, and it takes on a different shape when it dries, right? But it's the same substance. It's the same amount, the exact same molecules of wax, right? That now they had one shape, they were solid, then it became a liquid and it lost its shape and then it took on another shape. So it's got these changes in its qualities, but it's the same substance, right? Throughout the changes. That's the more fundamental or deep sense of what a substance is, right? And that's why the self is considered a substance, because even though you have changed a lot since you were a fetus in your mother's womb, you're still you, right? You're a self. You're the being who has been in that body and has been that body and that brain throughout all of the changes. It's still you, right? Okay, and mind is a real thing, because thoughts and consciousness and pains and all of those things exist in the mind. Wax is a substance. I explained that already. Person is the same person even after their hair and their teeth fall out and their memory goes. Okay, substance, atoms, and qualities. Right, there's test tubes. So material substance atoms are considered eternal, just like Empedocles and... was the first one who said that the four elements was a clever way of uniting Parmenides and Heraclitus. Parmenides, nothing, reality never changes. Parmenides said that. Heraclitus said, reality's always changing. And Empedocles said, well, the building blocks of reality, the four elements, earth, air, water, fire, atoms, well, he didn't call them atoms, but little particles, they never change, but the way they combine and decombine changes, right? So what reality is made out of is these little things, and they never change. But the relationships they enter into and exit from, those change, right? Same idea here. The atoms are eternal, the combinations are not. Isn't this amazing? In India... and in ancient Greece, ancient India, of course, there was communication between these cultures thanks to Alexander the Great, or Alex the G, as I like to call him, because he was old school gangster, took over the world. Okay, so yes, earth, right? Here's some earth qualities, right? Earth atoms are the physical substances, but the qualities that they have a color, a taste, a touch, a smell, they're solid and so on, right? Water also has a color, a taste, a touch, and its fluidity. It's not solid, it's fluid, unlike rocks, right? Fire has a color and a touch, and it's hot, right? And air has a touch and it moves, right? Air can have smells in it. They can be carried in air, right? Immaterial substances, right? So there are, oh, I forgot to point out, material is highlighted in the first bullet. These are material substance atoms, but then there are immaterial, non-physical substance atoms that are also eternal. The ether, that's what carries sound. It's inferred, it's all pervading, right? It's kind of more subtle. It might even include space. I'm not quite sure about that, the metaphysic relationship between ether and space. Right, but space is also, it contains, so they thought ether is what sound moves through, because it sometimes can move right through physical objects, right? But space contains physical objects, whatever. Time contains all events, all actions and changes occur in time. Heraclitus would agree. And it's also all-pervading and eternal. And the self, there's only one. Right? You have one self atom, that's you, but it's also pervades the whole universe, interestingly enough. But each of us has our own separate one. It's a little confusing to me. Don't feel bad if you're confused by that. Mind, one mind atom per self, right? Only the mind atom is not all pervading. So your soul, yourself, somehow or another is all-pervading, like Brahman, perhaps, but your mind is only yours. That's why I don't think your thoughts or feel your pains. Okay. There's more than one mind in the world. We just noticed that, right? Let's go back. Mind is only one per self. I'm a self, you're a self. There's two minds here, right? There's the two minds. Look at that. Which one are you? I think I'm the one on the right that looks male. The one on the left looks like it might be female. I don't know, softer eyes, lips red, my blue lips, whatever. Okay, selves are distinct and plural because so are these things. Consciousness, you're conscious one way, I'm conscious another. I have desires, you have different desires. I dislike certain things, I'm averse to them, you're not, right? I experience pleasures, you experience pains, and we don't experience each other's. I make efforts, you don't make efforts, right? I do my homework, you don't do your homework, right? You smoke pot, I don't, I drink wine. All right, minds are distinct from each other and from the self. This is just the reasoning that these philosophers went through, and that's how they figured out their metaphysics, right? So you process sensory information, your five senses feed into your mind, and my mind processes my sense perceptions. This is just straightforward common sense observation tells me that you and I are not the same. We are distinct. There's two of us, right? And this allows, minds allow you to perceive your own self, right? I can know what I'm thinking and feeling, and I can experience myself, right? Because I have my own mind. Otherwise, I would experience yourself, which could happen on LSD, by the way. All right. Don't try that at home, kids. Okay. So, classifying matter, pure substances versus mixtures. Right? Pizza is a mixture. You got bread, cheese, and sauce, some garlic maybe. Okay, qualities don't occur outside of substances. They only occur in substances, right? Color must be a thing that's colored, right? Colors don't just float around in the air. Things are colored, right? That's the idea. Qualities can't occur outside of substances. That's why we said substances are primary. They are rock bottom, metaphysically real. They are what ground all the qualities of things, right? So that pizza is yellow and red and green and whatnot, and those are qualities in the pizza. Without the pizza, no such qualities, okay? Pain can't exist outside of mind, right? That's an immaterial substance, right? Pizza is a material substance. So we're just following through this distinction in metaphysics, right? Numbers can exist both in objects and outside of them. So there's four objects on the screen in the picture, a glass of water, a salt shaker, a chemistry beacon, a flask or whatever you call it, beaker, and a slice of pizza with mushrooms, pepperoni, and maybe peppers, right? That's what it looks like, doesn't it? That's how I like my pizza. All right, pause for a sip. But you can have the concept of three or four or five. You can do math without the objects, right? That's what they mean that numbers can be in. And there could be two minds, right? That's an immaterial thing. My mind and your mind, myself and yourself. Okay, qualities are what makes substances known to us. How do I know that that's pizza, the substance of pizza? Because I can see the pepperoni, the mushrooms, the peppers, the cheese, the sauce, the bread, all that. It's those qualities. Qualities are the signs that there's a substance there. The qualities of wax let me know that that's a candle and so on, right? Without the shape, the size, the color, and so on, you couldn't know that that was wax. Right? Just an interesting thing to think about. Empiricism, if you recall, from the ancient Greeks, from Ionia, and the Milesians and the Ionians, by the way, are the same people, right? They're the empiricists. Pardon me. A strict empiricism would say, all we ever perceive is qualities. We never perceive substances. We infer them. Right? So from the taste, the smell, the look, the touch, the color, the size, we infer the substance of pizza. Even while we're chewing on it, we're inferring it from experiencing the qualities of that substance, that it's a distinct substance of a certain kind, which has those qualities. But what if all the qualities just happen to be hanging out together? They have no identity linking them. It's a deep metaphysical question. Are substances real? right? The Vaisheshikas think they're the most real. Some people deny that substances exist at all. Some Buddhists, for example. Okay, next category, universals, particulars, and inherence. This is 4, 5, and 6, I believe, on the being side, and then 7 is non-being, right? So the universals are the Platonic forms, right? The abstract, the concept of redness or roundness or circularity or whatever, as opposed to this red circle, which is a particular, right? And in the picture over there, Universal Studios, it's red and it's a globe, right? The universal concept of redness inheres in this particular picture, right? It's got this inherence relationship going on. I'm just repeating what I said earlier, right? Same and different, right? What's the difference between the universal of square and the universal of rectangle? A square is a kind of rectangle that has all equal sides. A rectangle need not have all equal sides, but the two vertical sides are equal to each other and the two horizontal sides are equal to each other, right? In the square, the vertical and the horizontal are all equal, right? So they square is like a rectangle. It is a particular kind of rectangle. Rectangularity inheres in the square, right? But what makes it different from other rectangles is that it has all equal sides. And rectangles, other non-square rectangles don't. So there's this concept of Aristotle's, again, of like and unlike, or genus and species. How are they alike? That's the universal. How are they different? That's the species differentiation between different universals, like sibling and brother and male and so on, right? So this is very, very similar to Aristotle. Redness is a universal. It occurs in many different substances. In this particular rose, it's a particular of red. Inherence is the glue that links redness with this rose, right? So that the redness inheres in that picture that you see on the screen, right? The particularity is the uniqueness of the same kind of thing. You might want to think of handball. You go to the store and they sell in a sporting goods store, Models. You want to buy a handball, right? And there's a bin with 100 of them. They're all identical, right? But there's this one and this one and this one. They're all instances of the same type of thing. They're all handballs, but there's this unique one and that unique one. You buy this one and you dirty it up and you write your name on it. Now you can tell it apart from the other one that doesn't have your name on it. But whether you wrote your name on it or not, they're still two different handballs. They're otherwise identical, but we call them, they're numerically distinct, even if they are they're quantitatively different, even though they're qualitatively identical. Okay, that's particularity or uniqueness. Now here's some really old school Indian music in the background. I only think it's appropriate to play Indian music while we're doing Indian philosophy. When we go to Chinese philosophy, we'll be doing the same thing. Okay, 1,000 identical earth atoms, each is particular. Universality is the sameness of all those otherwise identical handballs or bowling balls or lemons or whatever it is, you know? Oh, my controls are blocking my screen view over here. Ah, there it is. Yes. 1,000 unique atoms, but they're all earth atoms. That's part of the philosophy, okay? Okay, action is a real thing. Action changes things. A-C-T, action changes things. Right? Actions are real. They're part of reality, just like objects and substances and qualities are real and relationships are real. Particularity is real. Universality is real. Inherence is real. Actions are real. Actions are what cause changes in substance. So the wax changes from being solid to liquid when the action of fire underneath it heats it and melts it, right? That's an action that causes a change in the substance, okay? Vedic rituals are believed to cause changes in the cosmic order. The priest chanting and burning the fire and all that, propitiating the gods, doing what Euthyphro thinks is a good thing to do, tending to the gods, right? Upholds the Dharma, right? Everything in its place, everybody doing their duty, which is God's will. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, it says in the Lord's Prayer, the Christian prayer, right? The manifest world is in accordance with God's will, and the priest upholds that by performing actions that change the world from going out of sequence to keep it back in sequence. Okay, so this is one of the reasons why, since the Vedic, early Vedas particularly believe that pujas, those religious ritual performances, changed the direction of the world from falling apart to being restored and balanced. Okay, so built into Vedic philosophy is the idea that action is real. Karma is the fancy word for action, once again. And action is a cause, right? Anything that has the power to cause anything or to change anything is real. And that's an idea, by the way, in Western science. Right? What kinds of things are real? Anything that can have an impact on anything else, right? Anything that has a causal power is a real thing. The power to bring about some kind of change. Okay, so the Vedas is all about this idea that the actions of the priesthood and the ordinary person praying and chanting and meditating and doing, you know, the rituals and all that, change the structure of the world, keeping it together. Okay, so here we go now with negations. Right in the lower right hand corner, it looks like a moon with a little eclipse. Like us, imagine a smaller moon blocking, right? But really, what there's just an absence of light there, right? Because the illusion of a smaller black circle blocking the larger white circle, but that's just the absence of whiteness there. Like the absence of a body in the invisible man picture above, right? So absence or negation is a real category, oddly enough, despite Parmenides, right? It's odd because the system is very realistic. The system is based on stuff and particulars and substances that ground everything else that exists, but they believe emptiness or nothingness also exists, right? Like, well, maybe it's kind of like Democritus, atoms and void, right? Void is emptiness or absence of being. Atoms are being and void is absence of being, right? So what's real? The real world of objects, things, and persons, but also the world of no things in between, right? Reasoning is parts of reality are absences of other parts. Like I said, in this room that I'm in, there's an absence of anybody from the Harvey family that I grew up with. That's part of reality. There's no Harveys in this room. Absences are like shadows, right? Kind of like negative beings, right? You cast a shadow, it's not a thing. It's a kind of non-thing, right? It's just kind of weird metaphysics, right? There's no rose in this room. And a rose is not a cow, right? So a rose exists, but in that rose is non-cowness. That's another way of talking about it, right? Like in Professor Rapetti is non-elephantness and non-roseness. There's an absence of roses and elephants in what the substance that's Rick Rapetti, right? And a cow never grows a rose or becomes one, right? So all these other ways of thinking about things are ways of maybe analyzing reality built into this Vaisheshika metaphysics, the particulars, the followers of the school of particulars. Just think of things, substances, rocks, apples, trees, things, particulars. This apple, that apple, that's Vaisheshika metaphysics. But also, this apple is not a cow or Okay, so just remember, it is this weird way. There's a whole doctrine of, like, whereas Aristotle defines things positively, genus and species, right? There's a doctrine in this philosophy that goes something like this. How do you define a cow? A cow is everything that is not a non-cow. But because of the double negation, that just kind of really entails that a cow is a cow. It's just, of course, everything is itself, right? But that's why the logic goes with this, because that's the law of identity. It just comes about from a different angle. Remember the law of identity, Aristotle, A is a cow is a cow, right? Well, over here, it's a derived through a kind of negation of itself. A cow is everything that is not a non-cow. Right? I'm a non-cow, so I'm not a cow. A cow is everything that is not a non-cow, so it excludes everything that's not a cow, right? It's just approaching the same thing from a kind of different lot. So this, the fact that you can get the law of identity through this reverse approach is metaphysically and philosophically very interesting. Think about it. Okay. So, speaking of logic, let's go to the logic school, Nyaya. Remember, they accept the metaphysics of the Vaisheshika school, the particular school, right? This, the most important logic book is the Nyaya Sutra. Remember, the word sutra means, it literally means thread, but non-literally, it means a treatise or a discourse, right? Treatment, a theory, the textbook on something, right? And the philosopher's name is Gautama. By the way, the founder of Buddhism's name is also Gautama, right? His first name, but this is a different Gautama. Okay. So yes, they accept the realistic metaphysics of the Vaisheshikas. They add two new things. They introduce rules of method, proofs, and logic, like Aristotle's categorical syllogisms. They have their own syllogisms. Right? To prove that the objects and things that they believe are real actually do exist, right? So their logic is designed as an epistemological proof of knowledge about the metaphysics. And is focused on moksha. I don't know if you remember, I think I used the word in the previous lecture, but it means liberation, right? So the point of understanding reality and logic as the epistemological method for knowing and proving what is real is believed to be the philosophical methodology that leads to enlightenment or liberation, philosophical wisdom. Okay. And the word soteriological is a fancy word for salvation oriented, right? So the logic and metaphysics together are believed to be effective methods for attaining enlightenment, soteriological. I can't think of another word to come up with soteriological except salvation oriented or salvific. You might hear that in a religious context. Okay, so Nyaya criteria. What do we know? How do we know? So the criteria for valid grounds for logical inquiry, right? They say, you know, you have to have, you can't just be a kid asking why, that doesn't count. You can't just doubt, say, hey, you know, what if the whole world is just a figment in some God's imagination? What if we're in a test tube in another world, some kid with a chemistry set is experimenting on us, right? Like, those are just floating abstractions and possibilities. So hypothetical, they might be interesting speculations, but they're not really considered valid grounds for logical investigation of a phenomenon. What are the criteria for that? It has to be triggered by realistic doubt. Realistic doubt. Something happens, or you come upon some evidence or some condition or some phenomenon that causes real curiosity, uncertainty about the nature of reality, right? So it can't be idle. You know, you and your friends smoke a joint. You go, wow, man, I wonder if we're all real, right? No, that's not good enough, right? Okay. That might be how you get into philosophy, but as far as the Nyayas are concerned, you're posing, man. Okay, so not mere curiosity, but it has to be that something doesn't make sense. Here's an example of something that doesn't make sense, but it's not necessarily philosophical. You drive up to an ATM, an automated teller machine, where you go get your money out of the bank through the machine. And it's a drive-thru. You go up to the machine and you see that on the keyboard, you punch in your numbers and all that. They have Braille, which is those little bumps that people use their fingers to read who are visually impaired or blind or not sighted, so to speak, right? Then you think, people who drive have to see. So why is there Braille there? And you might have a million answers. Oh, well, maybe a blind person will just walk over there. Not a good idea where the cars are. Right? Oh, maybe a passenger in the car can't see. Well, then they can't even reach over, right? Or maybe they don't want to get sued for discriminating against. No, there's an economic explanation. It's cheaper for them to make one kind of machine and put them everywhere rather than use two different kinds of engineering to make two different kinds of ATM machines and then inventory, sorting them out and mailing the right ones to the right places and all that. Just do one kind, one size fits all. It's economically feasible, right? So that's not a philosophical puzzle, but it's an example of something in real life that doesn't make sense, right? So I remember when I was in Catholic school as a little kid, and I heard a story from one of the nuns about baptism, about suppose two babies died on the beach, one bay over from each other, right? And if one of them was fortunate enough that a Christian walked by and baptized them, you could just take water and touch the kid on the forehead and the chest and make the sign of the cross, say, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That child, even though it just died and is dead, right, freshly dead, sorry, this is gross, that child gets to go to heaven. The other child who didn't get baptized doesn't get to go to heaven. And I remember thinking, God knows everything. God's everywhere. God's all loving. He's all powerful. He's all good. He knew all that would happen. Babies are innocent. How is that fair that one baby gets to go to heaven and the other one doesn't, right? That doesn't make sense. I remember arguing with the nuns about that in like second grade or something like that. Here I am, I'm a philosopher now, right? But that's maybe an example of something philosophical that doesn't make sense, okay? That's what the Nyayikas are saying, followers of the Nyaya logic school, Nyayikas, right? The criteria for even engaging in philosophical or logical inquiry, when you inquire into something, you examine it, you're researching it, you're studying it, you're exploring it, right? You're analyzing it, examining it. That's inquiry. We call it inquiry. You're inquiring into it, questioning it, or Socratically cross-examining it, right? To be philosophically justified, it's got to be something like the two babies story, right? Or the Braille ATM machine. It could be philosophical. All right. So, that's criteria for valid grounds for logical inquiry, right? The criteria for valid objects of inquiry, like subjects that it's valid to inquire into, it has to be something that promises to remove false beliefs, false knowledge, right? Which is considered to be the cause of sorrow. So the Vedic philosophical system is all about religion, right? Cosmic order and the soul escaping suffering and coming into enlightenment or philosophical wisdom, right? So I don't know if it was Protagoras. I think I said in an earlier lecture that it was Protagoras who said, if a philosophy doesn't help human suffering, then it's not valid. But I don't think it was Protagoras. I think that was a mistake of mine. I think that was one of the Stoics, like Epictetus. In any event, it doesn't matter. That's the idea, right? So the category of inquiry has to be one that removes a false belief, and false beliefs are delusions that are believed automatically. You have a false belief, you've got a wrong map. If you have a wrong map, you're going to go the wrong way. If you go the wrong way, you're going to suffer, right? So you have to, it has to be one that will fix an important belief and reduce suffering, okay? Or one that leads to the highest good, which is enlightenment or liberation from rebirth. It's believed. See, we in the West, we wish that reincarnation was true. We like, wow, I hope reincarnation is true so that when I'm die, it's not over, right? But they believe, they so deeply believe in karma and reincarnation that it goes on and on and on endlessly. And it only ends when you become free of all your karma, when you become enlightened, you become a sage, like the seers who, the rishis who saw the Dharma and Rita and, you know, the truth came through them, like the prophets, right? That's the belief system, okay? So that's those are valid grounds for inquiry, okay? So let's give us a simple example, right? This is not so meaningful, but it's a simple model. We say, you have a warrant for something. When we use the word warrant in ordinary English, people think of an arrest warrant, right? But a warrant gives somebody, like a police officer, a right to go and do, to go and seize somebody, get the evidence, right? Right, but we use the word warrant in philosophy and epistemology as having a right to make a certain kind of claim, right? So you've got to have grounds for the claim, right? So the warrant in this example is the belief that dogs are animals that bark and howl. Oh, it's more like a wolf, but dogs howl too, right? And then the grounds for that is that you hear barking and howling in the distance, right? And then there you can therefore infer the claim, there are dogs nearby, right? That warrant, you have a warrant for the claim that there are dogs nearby because you hear barking and howling nearby, right? And you know that dogs are animals that bark and howl, right? This is a kind of epistemology that justifies logic and argument. This is the simplest thing, like all A's are B's in Aristotelian logic. This is a simple model, but you'll see it'll get a little bit more complex, right? With smoke and fire is the same idea, right? So there must be observational grounds for the proposition being inquired into and for the conclusion. Right? So the Vaisheshikas recall, believe in particular things like apples and oranges and rocks and fire and smoke and all that, right? So those are the foundations of evidence. They're the same as the foundations for metaphysics. Evidence is epistemology. How do you know something, right? Metaphysics is what things are real, okay? So for example, right? The warrant is the belief that where there's smoke, there's fire, right? This is supported by common observations, right? Whenever you follow through and follow the smoke, you find the fire, right? So the philosophy is grounded in observations of the pluralistic world that's believed in by the Vaisheshikas, right? They believe in a world of fire and smoke and trees burning and all, right? The objects in the world and the actions that they undergo, change and events and all that, right? Simple world of objects and their properties observed through our senses, logic plus observation through our senses are common sense methods, right? Common sense, realism, kind of logic, right? Common sense, realism. Reality is a plural world. There's many things in the world, rocks, tables, chairs, people, animals, gods, right? Reality is a plural world, a world that has more than one thing. It's plural. And that's perceived by our senses and understood by our reason, right? So now, the Nyaya method of argument, now it's going to get a little more formal, like all A's are B's, all B's are C's, therefore all A's are C's, but this is a different logic. It's not Aristotelian, right? There's five stages or limbs to a Nyaya argument. The statement of the thesis, that's the claim that's supposed to be proven, okay? So you start out with your conclusion, right? In Aristotle, you end with the conclusion. Well, here you start with the conclusion and you end with the conclusion, but it's not circular, and you'll see why in a moment. And then you give the statement of reason for your thesis or your claim, right? I believe this, that's number one, because number two, I give my reason why I believe it, my premises, right? And then you have to give an example that works as a rule that shows the link between the two, between the claim and the because statement for it, a rule of support that relates the rule to the thesis, okay? You'll see what we mean in a moment. And then you restate the thesis as proven, right? So you say, you give your claim, you say why, you give an example, and then you relate that example. You show how that example functions as a rule connected to the thesis. And therefore, you've established your thesis. You can repeat the thesis at the end as proven. Okay? So here's the example. There's fire on the hill. Oh, look at the picture. See? There's smoke. We don't see fire, but we want to conclude and prove that there's fire on the hill. Why is there fire on the hill? Because there's smoke on the hill. And what's an example that works as a rule of support? What's the rule of support? Where there's smoke, there's fire. For example, as seen in the kitchen, right? When we see the two close together, we see fire by the stove and, I mean, we see smoke by the stove and we look inside and the fire is what's causing, right? Smoke coming out of the oven. Oh. The food caught fire. It's too close to the fire, right? So there's smoke on the hill, right? That relates once again, right? The rule is where there's smoke, there's fire. Once again, there is smoke on the hill. So that relates the premise to the rule of inference. Conclusion, therefore, there's fire on the hill. All right. It's complicated. You might even just say, you like we would, our Western Aristotle style logic, we want to shrink this down and say, where there's smoke, there's fire. Premise one. Premise two, there's smoke over there. Conclusion, there's fire over there, right? So this goes two steps further. It repeats the conclusion. It starts with the conclusion, telling you what it wants to prove. It mentions the rule that where there's smoke, there's fire. It says that there's smoke, right? It kind of says that in two ways, right? First, it says that there's smoke. Then it says the rule where there's smoke, there's fire. Then it says there's smoke that relates to the rule. And then the conclusion again. Okay, there you go. All right. So one more little thing. Gotama has a proof of self, right? Thesis. There's a plurality of selves. That means there's more than one of us, right? Parmenides was wrong. We're not all the same one. All right, look at the picture. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different selves there. Why? Because, right? There's a plurality of selves. That's the thesis to be proven. Why? Because there's a plurality of consciousnesses, desires, hatreds, efforts, pleasures, and pains. Remember, my pain is not yours. You're angry, I'm happy, right? Those things are plural. Right, rule where there's a plural, where there are plural qualities, they inherit in plural substances, right? Like fire and water and this and that, you know, hot and cold, they don't inherit in the same, they can't be hot and cold at the same time. So there has to be one thing that's hot and another thing that's cold, right? Application of the rule, all these things are apparently perceivable, right? I can perceive that you're angry and I'm happy and he's neutral, you're in pain. He's ecstatic and I'm calm, right? And so on and so forth. You're on fire, he's underwater, and I'm lying in the sand, right? So we can observe that these qualities that inhere in distinct particulars. There's that Vaisheshika metaphysics, right? Substances are distinct and qualities inhere in substances, in distinct substances. Conclusion. There are many selves, okay? So that's Nyaya logic, proving that we have different selves. Parmenides is wrong. Okay, next school of thought, and we're going to pick up a little pace here. This is taking a while. this is one of the longest lectures, so I apologize for that. Samkhya is dualistic metaphysics. I mentioned earlier, right? Spirit and matter, or mind and matter, right? Samkhya means enumerating or counting, right? The number of categories, how many? Two, right? It's a Dvaita, dualism, not Advaita, which is non-dualism, right? Numbering categories of being. How many kinds of being are there? Two kinds. Purusha, which means consciousness, and each of us, as the Nyaya argument that we just saw says, there are many of us, right? Many distinct knowers. There's the knower and the known, right? Prakriti means matter, right? So there's consciousness and matter. Matter is one kind of thing, but it divides into many different kinds of things like earth, water, air, fire, and so on, right? So here's a little model on the right side. Matter, prakriti. Intellect is a kind of mechanical, computerized mind made out of matter. The sense of self, right? And then there's those qualities, sattva and tamas, right? Remember the three gunas, active, passive, neutral. Mind, five sense organs, five organs of action. We don't need to go into too much of this. The five subtle elements, gross elements, whatever. All right, so there's a Samkhya Karika. Karika means treatise or commentary, really. Treatise, like a sutra is a treatise. It doesn't matter what the differences are, right? It's a book, right? Suffering causes desire to overcome suffering, which requires an understanding of the distinction between things that are manifest and unmanifest and the knower. The knower, the mind, the subject of experience, the self, is suffering because it's embodied in matter, right? In prakriti, right? So mind and matter are blended together and that causes suffering. The knower is the consciousness, right? There's consciousness and matter. Purusha is like spirit or soul or consciousness or mind. And prakriti is matter, the body, the world, physical objects. And matter comes in two forms, manifest and unmanifest, right? Okay, so we're enumerating once again categories. How many kinds of things are there? Samkhya means counting or enumerating, numbering, two, that's how many. Okay, consciousness and moral. So there's two kinds of things, consciousness or mind and matter, but there are many minds, right? But there's only two categories of being, mind and matter. There's many minds and there's many kinds of matter, okay? We're all the same as a consciousness, right? It's like if we came off a conveyor belt as brand new CDs, blank, right? So we all have the same, that's like a model of what our consciousness is. We're all the same, we're all minds, right? But each of us is in a different body and has different history, different memories, and develops different desires and all that, right? But we're still all minds, right? We share this universal in the sense of mind. And matter is unconscious, right? And it's all one kind of stuff also, material stuff, substance, right? But it comes in many forms. And yes, this is the three gunas. A guna is a characteristic or a mode, a quality of being, right? Sattva is good or pure or light. This is like in acupuncture medicine, yin yang in Chinese medicine. You have yin and yang and neutral, right? Which is just the balance in the circle. Yin is female or negative. Yang is positive or male, right? And they're in harmony or balance. The circle represents the unity of both, which is kind of like balance, right? Or neutral, right? So you've got a similar kind of metaphysics here. These three qualities, pure, light, good, sattva. Second, rajas, active, fire-like, energy, passion, dynamic, right? Like maybe like yang in Chinese philosophy. And tamas is inactive, dull, dark, inertia, weighty, gravity, gross, heavy, sleepy, unconscious, stupid, right? These are all negative qualities, right? So there's positive and negative and kind of neutral sattva is pure. It's like the balance, right? So it's kind of like tamas is more like matter and rajas is more like fire or energy, right? And sattva is more like mind, clear, right? These are all just impressions that you get from even different foods are classified as being more rajasic or tamasic or sattvic, right? Garlic and heavy spices are rajasic, right? Some things that like tire you, you know, like turkey and eat a lot of food on Thanksgiving, it's tamasic, it makes you sleepy, right? So this is the idea, it's like kind of yin yang kind of thing, okay? Oh, there you go. Compare yin yang and neutral. Okay, so enumeration of the categories continue is mind, body, spirit, and self. But really, there's just two categories, mind and matter. So, yes, weirdly enough, in the material world, maybe it's not so weird because the brain is made out of matter, and that's where the mind is housed somehow or another, or built into, or structured in, or realized in, or manifest in the brain, right? So your reasoning ability is discriminates things. This is the same as that, but different from that. That's discrimination, differentiating, noticing same and different. That's the discriminator, the ego maker, the part of you that makes a sense of self, right? Then there's your sense organs, your five organs. Then there are your action organs, like your limbs and whatnot, right? The things you can do with your body, organs of action. Then subtle elements are like the chakras, these subtle energy centers in the body, and gross elements are like earth, water, air, fire. Okay, so discriminator, viveka means to discriminate, to differentiate, to identify that this is like this, but it's not like that. Like and unlike, that's discrimination, right? So your intellect differentiates objects. That's an apple, that's an orange, that's a dog, that's a cat, right? That's part of prakriti. That's part of matter, not part of consciousness, interestingly, right? The I maker, your ego sense, your sense of self. In this philosophy, that's considered a distortion. If you're not really separate, you're not your body. You're the consciousness. You're the purusha. Your sense organs, you're confused to think that you are your sense organs, right? The action organs, your voice, your hands, your feet, your reproductive organs, so on. These are parts of your body that enable you to do certain things, right? Your senses enable you to sense, to feel, to detect, to take in. Your motor organs allow you to do, to push out against the world, right? And then the five subtle things are sound and touch. These are almost mental. Right? You use your hand to touch, but the feeling of touch is a mental thing. So it's subtle, but physical at the same time. It's kind of very strange. And then the gross elements are the actual physical elements, right? Remember, earth, water, air, so on, fire. Okay, so knowledge is power. This is an idea in the Samkhya philosophy, right? Knowing that what the categories of being are enables you to know how you are imprisoned in your body, in your senses, in your action organs and all of that, because you have a false sense of self in which the purusha consciousness is identified with all these bodily things in the prakriti aspect of you, which is kind of like Plato might say, the cave version of you. The visible world, you're confused. You're not the visible world, you're the invisible world, right? To bring in Plato here, right? Or Neoplatonism, right? So having knowledge is freedom. Plato would say it, knowing what's true and what's an illusion, what's a shadow and what's the object that casts its shadow, right? It's the same idea here. Appearance and reality are not the same. By learning the difference between the two, you can become enlightened. So consciousness is confused by its conjunction. I put a question mark there. What's a conjunction? With prakriti. Conjunction means addition. An apple and an orange is a conjunction, two pieces of fruit, right? Or you say it's raining out and it's Tuesday. You've just conjoined two sentences. It's raining out and it's Tuesday, right? Or it's raining on Tuesday. That's a conjunction also in a sense. Although you don't see the word end in there, it conjoins two things, right? So consciousness is conjoined with the body, with the senses, with sensations and all that kind of stuff. And the I maker is the illusion that that's who I am. The sense of me doing all of this, that the baby develops after being here for a while. Okay. The discriminative faculty, like your thinking mind that says, this is like that. Oh, that's a dog. Mommy taught me dog, cat, yellow, green, round, square, triangle, food, bottle, water, bedtime, all the, right? So that's the discriminating mind, the mind that recognizes alike and unalike, same and difference. That's the discriminative faculty. That's where our thinking is going on. And so we associate that with me, I, the ego, the self. And I want, give me, I want, me, mine, that's not me, that's not mine, that's me, that's mine, right? That's the I maker, the self maker. It's an accident from confusion being in the conjunction of mind and body. That's the theory. Okay, and this takes manifest forms, right? Like I take my arms and my legs and, you know, my experiences to be myself. Right? And I develop desires and attachments to my body and my senses and the objects of my senses. I want that new car. I want that new cell phone. I want to win that video game. I want to, you know, have that sexual experience or whatever it is, right? I am all of those desires and I want all those. That's me, right? And that's what causes karma, because karma is action. So now I'm identified with all these things. I'm performing actions and all the actions have consequences. And that's my karma. And that is what causes reincarnation. My mind is wrongly identified with all my ego actions and desires and my body and all the things that I do. And I just keep creating more and more action. It's like kind of like a hamster on a wheel running endlessly as if it's getting somewhere, chasing its own desires. If I have more ice cream, then I'll feel better. And if I smoke a cigarette, then I'll feel better. If I watch a movie, then I'll feel better. I want. That's the theory, right? So this endless karma generating desire thing is what causes when you die, your body dies, but that energy is still there. It's a subtle energy. It's not physical. It's mental. It's psychic. Right. And so it's kind of like a subtle material substance, and it's because it's a powerful force. It just keeps going and you keep being reborn and reborn and reborn and reborn. And that's the theory. And then if you figure out how that works, you can transcend it and escape. Okay. So I just want to get my music up for a second and go to the next one. There you go. Okay. And let's go back to the current slide. Okay. There's those three gunas again. Sattva in the middle, light, balance, harmony, kindness, openness, clarity, intelligence, awareness, wellness, inspiration. Tamas is the heavy thing. You fall asleep with darkness, inertia, inactivity, heaviness, laziness, staleness, stability, materiality, I told you matter, insentience, a rock is not sentient, it can't feel, obstruction, right? But Rajas is the dynamic, fiery thing, energy, activity, change, passion, dynamic, egotism, agitation, excitement, movement, attachment, right? So this is like yin and yang and neutral, right? You see the neutral in the middle, right? So it's literally believed like to be a kind of spiritual physics about how Purusha consciousness is entangled in matter and in our senses and with the eye maker, with this tamas and rajas and sattvas. And when we figure out the physics of it all, then we realize, oh, I've got to balance the three gunas in my body through my diet and my thinking and my speech and my behaviors and my actions to bring it all into balance, to loosen up the ways in which my Purusha, my consciousness, is all entangled in my body and in the three gunas, right? So clean up my room, or as Jordan Peterson would say, make your yogic bed. I'm adding yoga to his speech, right? Make your bed, clean up your room, that kind of thing, right? That's the yogic approach, right? Because you want your spirit to escape from its prison in the body. There's a picture of an out-of-body experience there, right? The spirit leaves the body, right? Imbalances in the three gunas, the three modes, the three qualities of matter, of prakriti, are what makes matters worse, right? Knowledge of how that works enables you to become detached, to detach consciousness from matter. It makes it possible. Knowledge is power, right? Moksha, liberation, is detachment of consciousness, purusha, from prakriti, matter. Ending the reincarnational cycle of suffering, which is a similar idea in Buddhism. Buddha is trying to end the reincarnational cycle of karmic suffering and bondage, which you'll find out when we get to Buddhism. Can you see now why renunciation makes sense, and fasting to purify your appetites and things like that? It's not just to, you know, some abstract spiritual religious reason. This is a kind of physics. I have to clean up my room, my spiritual room, clean up my body, clean up my mind, right? So I can, you know, rebalance my gunas and get my matter and my spirit working in harmony so that I'm not entangled in this mess, wrongly identifying with ignorance, chasing my tail all the time, desire after desire, right? And then there's this language in Samkhya philosophy that the ego, the small self, the self with a small s, lowercase s, is not the true self, right? The true self, Purusha, consciousness, is the Atman with a capital A, which just means self, but with a capital S in English, or capital A for Atman, the soul, the self. You are your consciousness, not your body, right? Not your little ego. I want this, I want that, I, me, mine, that's mine, that's me. Right? No, the self is bigger than the body. Okay, so we got another argument about the plurality of different selves. There must be more than one, because there are many different births, deaths, activities, experiences, characteristics. Observation shows these do not belong to the same self, because things can't randomly cause anything different from themselves, right? Like a cow can't give rise to a human. Right? Roses don't grow out of cows. You can't be the self that has my pains. This is the same argument that we got from the Nyayikas, the followers of logic, right? You get this same argument in more than one school of Indian philosophy. Okay, three sources of knowledge. This is epistemology, right? Epistemology, what are the sources of knowledge? A source of knowledge is, by the way, called a pramana in Sanskrit. Right, a mode of cognition, or a valid means of knowing, a valid means of cognition. Cognition is another word for knowing. Perception, what you see. Inference, what you reason. And those two things are empiricism and rationalism, right there, right, from the ancient Greeks. Empiricism is perception. Inference, or reason, or logic, is rationality, right, rationalism. And testimony. Testimony is a kind of extended knowledge from other people's perception and reason. What other people claim, like the seers who wrote the Vedas, they're saying they heard the Dharma, they heard the eternal truths of the universe being spoken to them when they were on soma, which is like acid, right? Interesting philosophy. So here's an interesting thing, however, in Samkhya epistemology. When perception and inference contradict testimony, testimony loses out, right? So if somebody says, oh, I saw a round square, really, like a miracle, I saw a miracle. Well, I'll use a round square because you might believe miracles are possible, but you know, you can't possibly see a round square, right? So if somebody's testimony, if their testimony is that they saw a round square, perception and inference tell you there can't be a round square. The meaning contradicts itself, right? And I've never seen a round square. Nobody's ever seen a round square. You couldn't. It's impossible. It's logically contradictory, right? Then testimony loses out. So testimony only works if it doesn't contradict reason and perception. Reason and perception. Okay. Expert testimony. Perception based on the five senses. There's pictures of the eye, the ear, the nose, and so on. And the brain is the picture of the reasoning, the inference. Right? So here's an example. Right? Samkhya. The Upanishads say that Atman is Brahman. Right? This individual self is the one, right? Brahman. But reason and observation suggest otherwise. On the previous slide, I'm a different self from you. Remember the argument for many selves? Okay. Yoga, that's the fourth school. Yoga is the method of liberation based on Samkhya philosophy. Right, and the authority on it is the Yoga Sutras, the Yoga Treatise written by Patanjali around 2,000 years ago. Sayings about union becoming one with Purusha, right? Not Brahman, right? Where your Purusha, your consciousness, which is infinite but is distinct from mine, interesting, remember? You become one with yourself. The small self unites with the larger self. It's a comprehensive instructional manual. My whole next lecture is on yoga philosophy, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. So I'm not going to say much about it here. Theory, method, technique, map of mental states, map of meditation techniques, all sorts of stuff, fascinating stuff. All right, but I'll go through really quickly. The opening line, which I talk about in the next lecture, says, herein lies the essence of yoga. Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha, that's Sanskrit. Yoga means union, Chitta means mind, consciousness like Purusha. Vritti means movement or waves, and Nirodha means stopping, right? So union is achieved by stopping the waves of mind, stilling the mind. That's the whole philosophy of yoga. Union, yoga achieved. Liberation is attained by calming or stilling the mind. Very simple. Bringing the mind to one point. Like I said, I have another lecture on this, so I'm not going to go into it here. But I will give you one little picture about it. Yoga, the yoga darshana, the yoga philosophy accepts Samkhya metaphysics, right, of Purusha and Prakriti, right? Mind fluctuations, the movement of the mind is what confuses you about reality, all your thoughts spinning around. And it confuses your consciousness with the fluctuations and movements of your body. So by calming the mind and body, right, you can escape the illusion. You think the world, your body in the world is your real self, but your real self is your consciousness. So the still lake metaphor in that picture, right? Yoga is the path to stilling the mind and body, making it perfectly clear, calm. And then you can see through the illusion and realize that you're Purusha, your consciousness, you're not your body. Right? There's the lake moon metaphor. Oh, yes. When you calm the lake, when it's perfectly still, it functions like a mirror. You can see the moon, which is the self in this metaphor. Okay. Purusha is a passive witness, right? And it mistakenly thinks it is matter. Right. Ignorance and karma conjoins them. Remember this conjunction, the integration of the two. Liberation is when you realize I am not this yin and yang, the three gunas and all that stuff. I'm not all that activity. I am not that. I am Atman, right? Purusha, the soul. Liberation detaches the soul from the body. Yoga meditation is the way. Perfect one-pointedness stills the mind, bringing your mind to focus on one thing. When that happens, you as the consciousness and the object of consciousness, like a candle flame that you're meditating on, you become one, right? Union, united, yoga. That's non-dualism, right? In a sense, subject and object. Purusha and Prakriti are no longer confused and intertwined. Purusha is one with itself, and it's not two in the body. Even though there is Prakriti and there's Purusha, there's a kind of non-dualism in Purusha when you attain enlightenment in the yoga philosophy. Okay. Oh, my sequence of things posted here is in their own form. Mimamsa is a kind of epistemology that just revolves around the Vedas, right? As the truest source, of, like divine revelation to prophets speaking what God said, right? So it's the highest knowledge of the highest reality, directly heard and seen by enlightened sages called rishis, can't be overthrown by the senses or reason because they transcend both, right? What the sages say, right? So this is different from the other folks who said, if testimony contradicts reason and observation, get rid of testimony. Here they're saying, no, the testimony of the sages who wrote the Vedas, that's top dollar. If your senses go against that, get rid of your senses, right? Jesus said, if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. That's a similar thing here, right? The Vedas are an absolute scripture. You can't deny them. They're written by God, so to speak, right? Can't be negated by what is visible, right? Say, oh, I'm pointing my observation goes against what it says today. Well, the Vedas are about what's invisible, the ultimate reality from which the visible world emanates, like Plato, right? The invisible world is the intelligible world. The Vedas is a map to the intelligible world on this model, right? So early Vedas is all about rituals that uphold the order in the cosmos by performing pujas, religious rituals. The word kriya, which is similar to the word karma, which is an action. A kriya is a purifying action, right? Which preserves the rita, the order of the universe, and the dharma, your role, your duty, you know, your right place in the universe. There's a puja going on, a fire ceremony there with some Brahmins. Okay, I mentioned pramanas in a previous epistemology, that reason or inference and observation and testimony, those were three pramanas in the Samkhya epistemology, right? So here we have six pramanas, right? This is from Yogapedia, like Wikipedia. So you've got perception, upper left, and inference, upper top. Lower left is testimony. Those three we've already heard about them in Samkhya. But then there's comparison or analogies. This is like that. So they share some things. You might not have seen it in that, but you could see it in here. Now you know that they're alike, so you could see the same thing in there. When you make an analogy, that's like this, right? Similarity, right? Postulation is like when you postulate something, you make an assumption or a hypothesis, right? And that can be a source of knowledge. You have a hypothesis or an assumption or a postulate, and then you work out the reasoning for it and you test it in different ways. And then non-apprehension is like the negation thing. We don't see any elephants here, so there are no elephants here, right? We saw that earlier on in the very first school, the Vaisheshikas, right? The negation category. So this is a very complex epistemology. The Vedas are considered absolute, but then all the other pramanas, right? The Vedas is testimonial knowledge, right? So this is a really cool epistemology, the different sources. So something is valid a knowledge claim is valid if it comes to us through one of these, or more than one, or we can test one against the other. Okay, whoops, sorry. So now the last school, and this will be relatively quick, is Vedanta, the end of the Vedas, that's the Upanishads. And the focus is on moksha, on liberation. Instead of the focus on rita, upholding the dharma and the cosmic order and all of that through ritual pujas and kriyas and cleansing and all that kind of religious euthyphro kind of stuff, right? It's all about enlightenment, liberation, right? The individual soul's attempt to become enlightened or liberated, as opposed to just doing your duty and upholding and being a good priest or something like that. Right, but there's three major differences in the Vedanta school, which is probably the most popular school in Indian philosophy today. That and yoga. There's overlaps between all of these, right? Especially between yoga and Vedanta. So the main question is, how many beings are there? One or two, or one and two? right? So three famous Vedanta philosophers historically are Shankara, who says there's only one. That's Advaita, non-dualism, if you recall. Madhava, which is Dvaita, dualism. There's God and everything else is separate from God. I'm not God. You're not God. Rocks and chairs and trees aren't God. God is God. And then there's a created world and created beings, right? And then there's a kind of combo. Well, they're both kind of right. God is God, and God is separate from all kinds of beings who are separate from each other, which is got Samkhya, right? And philosophy, which goes with yoga, right? But it's a kind of like synthesis, right? That, you know what? On some fundamental level, it's kind of like Neoplatonism, Ramanuja, right? There is a one, there's a many, they're totally distinct, but they're ultimately just one. Different aspects or modes of the same or levels of being in the same one being, all right? And I mentioned all three of these in the previous video. So we will end, that's a mudra. A mudra is a hand gesture, right? And on the right hand, the other hand is with the ink all over it. Well, they both have ink on it, but one like this, is one mudra. The open hand shows the circle with the, what looks like a three in it. That's the Om sign. That's the letter Om in Sanskrit. And Namaste means, Nama means bow, or I respect, I bow, I honor. And Aste comes from the word for like Astika, which means being, remember? An astika is a follower of being. So these orthodox schools follow the true being from the Vedas, right? Aste has to do with self or being, right? So namaste means I honor or bow to yourself. And I've heard many translations of namaste, but at the end of yoga classes nowadays, that's a standard way. People put their hands in prayer pose, they bow their head a little bit and they say namaste, which means I bow to the divinity in you or to the light in you. Or one of my meditation teachers said, I bow to the part of you, which is like the part of me, or the same being that's in you, that's in me, or the part of me that is the same as the part in you bows to that same thing, and so on and so on and so on. But namaste is also just a greeting. Like ciao in Italian, which you could say hello or goodbye. Ciao when you meet someone, hey, ciao. And when you're leaving, ciao, right? Or in Greek, it's yasu, yasu, hi. And then when you leave, yasu, see you later, right? So namaste could be a hello or a goodbye, just a simple thing. Or namaskar is an alternative version of that. That Indians just say that a lot, just hello and goodbye kind of thing. But it's a courtesy, and it's a very nice thing. So there it is, namaste. Let me end the screen so you can see my pretty face. And I hope that wasn't too long. Hope it was interesting. And there was a lot in there, but remember your six schools now. Till next time. Ciao. Namaste.